What's up? Alec here. Welcome to Soulful Guitar Lessons. Today, we're going to go through the top 20 R&B soul guitar intros of all time. I am super, super excited for this episode today. I did a lot of research on this and I learned a ton, and I know you will too. And you're going to want to stick around to the end because I have some bonus material I don't want you to miss out on. So let's get into it, okay? So song number 20 on the list is by Curtis Mayfield, a song called Freddy's Dead. Let's take a listen. So this song came out in 1972, and it was the score to a movie with the same title. And here's the interesting fact. This song actually outgrossed the movie itself, which is one of the only soundtracks to ever do that. I had no idea about that. That's a cool little interesting fact. Song number 19 is Clean Up Woman by Betty Wright. Let's play it. Okay, so this song is kind of a common theme for soul R&B intros. So you're gonna have this one guitar doing like that melody kind of thing, and then there's another counterpoint, you know, a second guitar that's going and that's a really common thing. You're gonna notice that that's like a little thread throughout this top 20. So this song was the single. It was released in 1971, but it actually came out on an album in 1972. It was sampled by Chance the Rapper in his acid rap mixtape, shout out Chicago. And that guitar you hear in the intro is played by a guy named Willie Little Beaver Hale. And this is a cool thing too, throughout this top 20, I really want to give you like the backstory, some insight, and who actually played these riffs, because a lot of times we see just the name, you know, it'll be like, oh, Curtis Mayfield, or oh, The Temptations, but I want you to know who played the guitar and who played these instruments. And you're gonna notice some themes going forward as well that I want you to pay attention to. Song 18, Stevie Wonder's For Once in My Life. All right, let's play it. Doing my research, I had no idea that Stevie Wonder did not write this song. And it was actually like a jazz song released years prior by like Nancy Sinatra and like these jazz crooners. And it was really done as a slow ballad. And then Stevie Wonder came out with this version that was up-tempo and in like a soul Motown feel. And that is actually the most recognizable version that we all know and love today. But really, it started out as a jazz ballad. And you could kind of tell that through like the chord changes. They're like pretty intense, heavy jazz chords. All right, song number 17, Whatever You Want by Tony. Let's take a listen. So the first thing I'm hearing two things. I'm hearing some insane harmony going on. I'm also hearing some really cool guitar effects. To me, it sounds like the guitar, there's an octave up and then there's an octave below the guitar. Like it's like almost like a pedal. You could do that with the EHX Pog, not to get too deep in nerdy, you know, guitar pedal world. And this song was released in 1991. It was written by Dwayne Higgins. And here's the thing. I would love, if you, anyone out there knows who played guitar on this, my inclination is to say it might be Raphael, it might be Jubu. So if anyone actually knows, I would love to know. Put it in the comments section below. Song number 16 is by Sly and the Family Stone, I Wanna Take You Higher. This song was written in 1969, and it was actually the B-side to the song Stand. The guitar player is Freddie Stone playing that opening riff. It's kind of almost like a rock riff, like almost like a bluesy rock riff. Song number 15 is Fly Me to the Moon by Bobby Womack. So this is different than the 1964 version that we know Quincy Jones and Frank Sinatra did. This was later on in 69, and this was actually from Bobby Womack's debut album. So here's a nice little interesting fact that I did not know. Bobby Womack started off playing with Sam Cooke as a session guitar player and touring with Sam Cooke. And then later, Bobby Womack branched off, did his own thing. But originally, he was touring since he was 10, and he then later got picked up by Sam Cooke, who was part of the Soulsters. They did like a little gospel thing. Song number 14, Aretha Franklin, the Queen of Soul, Chain of Fools. Let's take a listen. Chain, chain, chain. The song was written in 1967 off her Lady Soul album. This song actually was not written by Aretha Franklin. It was written by a guy named Don Covey, who wrote songs for the Rolling Stones and Wilson Pickett, Otis Redding, and a bunch of other folks. And actually, this song, according to my information, was written with Otis Redding in mind, but later on, got given to Aretha Franklin. And it starts off with this baritone guitar. It's not a normal guitar. So a baritone guitar, if you don't know, is just tuned down a fourth. So the low string starts on a B, and then it's tuned accordingly. And that baritone guitar was played by a guy named Joe South. Next, we have a song by the iconic Jackson 5, I Want You Back. You've heard this at every wedding you've ever been to. You've heard this all over. Let's take a listen, though, one more time. Those octaves, iconic. Pause it right now. Okay, so we have those octaves, so iconic. You're going to hear that all the time in, you know, soul music throughout the next generations. And Kool and the Gang did it and Celebrate. They started off the whole song with that. And then you have that second guitar playing those chords and what would be known to some viewers as neo-soul, but really it started in the 60s. Cats playing these nice hammer-on pull-offs, the same shapes that we've been now we see all over in social media, but really it started a long, long time ago. This song was released in 1969. It was the first number one hit for the Jackson 5. So three guitarists are credited on playing this song. They are Lewis Shelton, Tito Jackson, and David Walker. Song number 12, we have the Hall & Oates song, Sarah Smiles. Let's take a listen. This song was released in 1975. It was off their fourth album. So I chose this song. I know there might be some controversy in the comments section, but I chose this song because that signature riff, especially that lead guitar, is so iconic, so signature, that if you play that intro, just the first 1 second in any bar or club, you immediately know what it is. I freaking love that song. I actually played that song for the first time a couple months ago, even though I've been listening to it forever. And I was like, wow, this line is actually kind of more challenging than you would think. Hopefully in some future videos, we can go and break down some of these top 20 songs. But until then, we're going to keep going. Song number 11 is the iconic Marvin Gaye song, Let's Get It On. Let's take a listen. So that wah pedal that comes in, absolutely iconic. It's like, this song has almost become like a parody for lovemaking or sexuality. You'll see it in sometimes comedy movies, but you know, it originally started off, actually this song was from Marvin Gaye's 13th album. 13 albums. This dude was cranking out hit after hit. And most cats, most bands don't get to 13 albums. Most bands don't get to two albums. And this guy was cranking out hit after hit, and he never had any down period. It's absolutely remarkable. Marvin Gaye got his start in Motown, and he continued just cranking out the hits. So I want to read you something. This is from the liner notes. Marvin says, "Have your sex. It can be exciting if you're lucky. I hope the music that I present here makes you lucky." So if you hear at 13 seconds, roughly, I notice like the guitar player is, he's vibing and whatever, but he hits kind of like that open note, and I think it's a G note, and he hits it, and that's not intentional. I'm gonna play it for you. But it just goes to show that if the vibe is right and like the spirit is there, it's not always the case, especially back then, that the take has to be 100% perfect, immaculate. I know today in like pop music, that is totally the case. It has to be pristine, immaculate. But back then, it was a vibe. Track number 10 is Mr. Big Stuff by Gene Knight. Let's take a listen. So Mr. Big Stuff was released in 1971, and it was actually recorded in 1970 at the same session as King Floyd's Groove Me Baby. If you've ever heard that song, you compare them side by side, kind of a similar vibe. And that's because it's at the exact same session. Song number 9 is Love Train by the OJs. Let's take a listen to it right now. This song was released in 1972, and it reached the number one song on the Billboard Top 100. It was written by a songwriting team, Huff and Gamble. And so the band for this single is based out of Philadelphia. It was a group of about 30 studio musicians, and I had no idea that this is what they were called. They were called Mother, Father, Sister, Brother. And they'd backed up a ton of people like Wilson Pickett or the Stylistics, and the list goes on and on. But I had no idea that these musicians backed up so many people. And this is what's so cool about doing this research, doing this top 20, is you learn a lot. I hope you're taking away a bunch of nuggets. Song number 8 for our top 20 is Get Down On It by Kool & the Gang. Let's take a listen. Oh, what you gonna do? You wanna get down? Tell me. Oh, what you gonna do? Do you wanna get down? Oh, what you gonna do? You wanna get down? Oh, what you gonna do? You wanna get down? Woo. So you hear again, there's that two guitar, you know, you have that single thing, you know, playing a single note, and then you have the other guitar, you know, doing like chordy thing. That's a super common thing on this top 20 countdown. And just in R&B soul music in general. This song was released in 1981. And here's a cool, I had no idea, again, doing this research, I had no idea that Thelonious Monk was Kool's godfather. No idea. But Thelonious Monk, if you don't know, is an amazing jazz musician. One of his most popular songs, Round Midnight. I would encourage you to go check that out. We don't have time for that here. Just go check out that. So Kool & the Gang started out as Kool & the Flames, but you know, James Brown at the time, his backing band was called the Famous Flames. So in order to separate themselves, Kool & the Gang, well, they were called Kool & the Flames, but then they had to start calling themselves Kool & the Gang so they wouldn't be confused and have a whole plagiarism issue and whatever. And that was in 1969. Kool & the Gang started off as an instrumental group. And only later on did they realize, oh, we need to have vocals if we really want to have mainstream success. If you'll listen to some of their earlier songs, like Funky Stuff, it's like kind of this Hollywood swinging. You got this kind of like funky 70s swinging kind of vibe. And later on, you're going to get their smash hit Celebration. But this song, Get Down On It, really has that guitar intro, especially those two guitars that I'm looking for in this type of top 20 list. Super iconic, and hopefully in future videos, we'll be able to do a breakdown of some of these top 20 songs. If not all, that would be so, so fun. Song number 7 is It's Your Thing by the Isley Brothers, released in 1969. Let's take a listen. Alright, so we're gonna pause it. I love this song. The Isley Brothers have been around since the 50s and they are still going. It is 2022 at the time this video is made. That is an absolutely incredible career. This song was written by the Isley Brothers. It was actually one of the few songs on our top 20 list that is written by the artist that is also performing. This song, you can hear it starts off with that guitar going boom, boom, boom. It's a call and response thing, so that's a call. And then the piano does a little response with the chordy thing. And then the guitar goes back, da-da-da-da-da-da, and then the piano responds. And that's a really, really common thing in music, call and response. It's like, I say something, and you respond. So Ronald Isley, the writer of the song, said he wrote this while dropping off his daughter one day. You know, it's funny like that. Sometimes songs or revelations don't come to you while you're in the studio. You know, they come to you while you're out and experiencing life and experiencing the world. So he dropped off his daughter one day, had this idea, rushed home, showed it to his eldest brother, who's like, oh yeah, that's a good song. And then they hit it in the studio and they recorded two takes and boom, it was done. That guitar you hear is Charles Pitt playing that riff. Song number six is a song by Bobby Blue Bland, Ain't No Love in the Heart of the City. Let's take a listen. Once again, the song uses two guitars, one playing that main riff, and then another one playing just some chords. And you're gonna notice a lot of times they're in different octaves. So this song, there's like a low octave guitar, you know, you're playing like down here, and then the other guitar is playing up here. That is just so the, you know, you have like, it's almost like having an alto and a baritone, or, you know, or sorry, a baritone and an alto, you know, just to not confuse the listener, just to different registers. And it's just such an iconic song. I remember first hearing this song from Jay-Z, and Kanye West produced it off his Blueprint album, Ain't No Love in the Heart of the City. And I was jammed to, I absolutely love this song. And then my brother, who's a producer, my brother Ryan Lehrman, who's a producer in Chicago, and he was like, you know, when we were much younger, he's like, yo, this is actually a sample from this guy named Bobby Blue Bland. I was like, no way. So I went and checked it out years and years ago. And I absolutely love this song. This song was written in 1974 by Michael Price and Dan Walsh, first recorded by Bobby Blue Bland. So again, this is one of those situations where the songwriters are different than the actual performing artist. Doesn't at all take away from the amazing performance. Iconic. Number five, My Girl by The Temptations. You know it, you've heard it at weddings, you've heard it at so many events. Let's take a listen. I've got sunshine. Let's take a pause there. That is James Jamerson of the Funk Brothers playing the bass. That's Robert White on the guitar. So the Funk Brothers were the house band for all these amazing Motown artists in the 60s and 70s. And there's actually a documentary called Standing in the Shadows of Motown that was put together, and it does a whole, it goes a deep dive on the Funk Brothers. I strongly recommend you check it out. I should rewatch it. It's just fascinating because a lot of, you know, up until that documentary, not a lot of people knew who the Funk Brothers were, even though they were the sound behind literally thousands of hit records. Nobody really knew who they were by name or didn't even know about them. So I would recommend checking out this documentary. This song was written by Smokey Robinson, and it was written in response. So the year prior, Mary Wells, who Smokey Robinson wrote this song as well, she came out with a song called My Guy, and My Girl by The Temptations, a year later, was just kind of a response and telling the same story just through like a male perspective, you know, and having that guitar line, so iconic. Like, you play that anywhere, people know My Girl. Number four, It's a Shame by The Spinners. Let's take a listen. Again, the two guitars. The backing band was the Funk Brothers, but I had no idea. This song was produced by Stevie Wonder. At the time, Stevie Wonder was literally cranking out so much music, he couldn't even release it all under his name because he was just like a vessel for greatness. So the folks that played that intro, the two guitar players, are Dennis Coffey and Eddie Willis. Again, just giving you a background on some of these folks that, you know, might not just have a name other than like we're identifying them here and giving them a voice, giving them a name, giving them some limelight, because a lot of times the only people that see the limelight are, you know, the artist or the lead singer. And I really think it's cool to do a deeper dive and know some history on this music. Number three, we got a song, once again by the Isley Brothers, called That Lady. Let's take a listen. So this was released in 1973, and something I didn't know, once again, was back in the early 60s, they had already released and written this song, but it was in like a bossa vibe, and it was slow, it was kind of like this R&B feel. And then later on in the 70s, they re-released the song, like a reinterpretation of the same thing, and that's what ended up becoming the smash hit. So if you hear, there's two things going on. There's like that clean guitar playing the chords, and then you have Ernie Isley playing that lead guitar. And if you notice, that lead guitar sounds an awfully like Jimi Hendrix. And if you wonder why, Jimi Hendrix in 64 was playing guitar as the guitar player for the Isley Brothers. So Ernie learned a lot from Jimi, and you know, if you could tell, he's kind of ripping Jimmy off, as we all do. I rip Jimmy off. Most guitar players rip Jimmy off, but he's doing his own thing. He's got a cool little like phaser thing going on, which Jimmy never really played with the phaser. In 2014, Kendrick Lamar, arguably one of the greatest rappers and hip hop artists of our generation, my generation, he sampled this song for a song called I. And rather than going through all the lawyers and being like, hey, I want to use your song, Isley Brothers, he showed up at Ronald Isley's door and personally asked permission. That is such a classy thing to do. I guess if you're Kendrick Lamar, you can do that. Number two, we have Al Green's song, Love and Happiness. Let's take a listen.
Love and happiness. Something that can make you do wrong, make you do right. Yeah. Love. Love and happiness. Wait a minute, something's going wrong.
So this song came out in 1972 off Al Green's I'm Still in Love with You. It was written by Al Green and his guitar player, Teenie Hodges. So this song actually almost didn't make the album. So normally the way it would go about, they cut songs that Al Green wrote, and at the very end, they decided to put this song in because, you know, Teenie Hodges and Al Green wrote it. And normally, Teenie explained, like, okay, well, normally that was, like, the last thing to do if they needed to fill some type of, you know, track list or void in the album. So they cut this song. And what's pretty incredible, they did it all live, and timing was really, really important to, you know, the overall vibe of this song. So when Al Green's doing that little intro, It's rubato, it's out of time. And they were struggling to get the timing and the vibe of this song down. So if you hear right before Teenie starts playing that guitar riff, you're gonna hear a count off, and he's counting off with his foot. So anyways, Teenie just counted off with a discarded Coke crate. not a drummer doing a 1, 2, 3, 4, just what was around in the studio. And what's cool, it kind of just adds to the overall vibe and organic feel of the song. Number one, the number one song, what we've been waiting for. It's by Tony, Anniversary. Let's take a listen. This song was released in 1993 off the Sons of Soul album, played by Jubu Smith. Jubu later joined Maze featuring Frankie Beverly, another amazing R&B soul group. But this intro is an amazing, like, it's so smooth. Nobody sounds like Jubu. He has his own thing going on. And it totally makes this song. If you want to check out, I did a little tutorial on how to play this song. So I'll add that in the description box below. So this song was written by Rafael Sadiq and keyboardist Carl Wheeler. I first came across this song like maybe 5, 6 years ago, and I'd never really gotten into Tony. But it's funny, like you keep going back, you're like, oh, what song is this? And you keep going back in history and you realize like, so many things are connected. Also, I didn't mention before, he's in this amazing like gospel group called the Soul Seekers. And I've learned so much from just studying Jubu Smith through records. Never met him, I would love to meet him, but absolutely a titan of guitar. And that is why this song is number one. So at the beginning of this video, I did tell you to stick around to the end, and here is why. We got some honorable mentions. The first one is Kiss by Prince. Now, I can't actually play that song here on YouTube because they'll block this video. But it starts off, you know, Kiss, one of Prince's biggest songs. Absolutely incredible. Next honorable mention we got here is Hung Up on My Baby by Isaac Hayes. Let's play it. All right, we've come to the last honorable mention. It is by the Jacksons. Enjoy Yourself is the title of the track. Let's take a listen. Thank you so much for tuning in. I hope you learned a lot. I definitely learned some nuggets along the way researching this video, and it was really cool to just go back and experience all these songs again. Let me know if you disagree with anything, like, you know, oh, this is actually not the top 20 that you think it should be. Let me know in the comment section. I'd love to hear what you are thinking. Again, thank you and take care.